Hi, Cove family. I was wondering if you could do something with me real quick. Let's all take a few deep breaths together this morning as we try to enter and center ourselves on God. So let's take like 3 deep breaths with me. Thank you for doing that. My name is Russell and I'm on staff here at the Cove. And whether this is your first time here or you've been here every week, I welcome you and I'm glad you're here. If you're anything like me and my family, in some ways it's been harder to get to worship these past couple months, even though, you know, all you have to do is sit down or stand up if you want and hit a few buttons and you're good to go. Somehow, just making that happen and getting everyone to sit down together is harder than making sure everyone's ready, packed up, and driving up or down the 101 to get to the Cove. So yeah, if you're anything like me, maybe amidst the quietness or the noise of your home, the stress or sadness, the peace or joy you might be experiencing this morning, it's my prayer that you bring it with you to God this morning. So like when we took a few breaths to slow down and center ourselves on God, again, I pray that you are able to do that with whatever you bring with you this morning. And I've been feeling that mixture of peace in my life as things have slowed down quite literally. I get to be home more, driving around town a lot less. Just things have felt slower and less stressful. But on the other hand, you know, I felt the burden of what's going on in our country with the pandemic and the world and all the suffering and looking for where God is present in this time. So I found Psalm 102 to be really helpful for me with what I've been feeling. And if you're anything like me, I think this scripture will speak to you as well. So I wanted to read just a little bit of Psalm 102, I think the first few verses and then a chunk later in it. Hear my prayer, O Lord. Let me cry for help. Let my cry for help come to you. Do not hide your face from me when I am in distress. Turn your ear to me. When I call, answer me quickly. But you, O Lord, sit enthroned forever. Your renown endures through all generations. You will arise and have compassion on Zion. For it is time to show favor to her. The appointed time has come, for her stones are dear to your servants. Her very dust moves them to pity. The nations will fear the name of the Lord. All the kings of the earth will revere your glory, for the Lord will rebuild Zion and appear in his glory. He will respond to the prayer of the destitute. He will not despise their plea. Amen. Let's worship together this morning.
Okay.
Lately, we've been doing a testimony series about every other week where one of the Cove saints shares their faith journey, their testimony, how God has met them, brought them to faith, or just something they're learning. And I've been really encouraged by it because as we've been doing the sermon series about walking by faith, we get to hear examples of people in our midst from our own congregation and how they've walked by faith and how God has met them on their journey. So this morning, I'm excited to introduce to you Roxanne, and I'm excited, well, a little selfishly, she's gotten me hired, helped get me hired at the Cove and a different church before. And not that it's about me, but Roxanne has served at a lot of different churches in California and many years on Young Life staff. So it's cool. We get to hear this morning her story about how God met her when she was younger and called her, and how God shaped her back then has shaped the trajectory of her life and her ministry. So let's hear what Roxanne has to say.
Growing up, I spent a lot of time waiting for my life to start and not really living life. I mean, waiting to be chosen or waiting to belong to a group or create a friendship and anything that might be meaningful. I had a loving family and I had three siblings, but I felt stagnant, maybe even bored with life, and I was still very young. Then the summer before my senior year in high school came, and my parents sent my brother and I, my brother was 1 year younger, to a Young Life camp called Malibu in Canada. So we regularly went to church in Whittier, which is in Southern California. Going to Malibu was the first time that I actually remember hearing anyone talk about having a personal relationship with Jesus. I didn't receive Jesus into my heart at that time, but I listened carefully and I got involved with leading music in Young Life in the Whittier Club and in a bunch of clubs in Orange County too. And so 5 years later, when I was about 22, and I was responsible and I was reliable, and I was a young adult who cared about teenagers. And I was asked to counsel 16 girls at another Young Life camp called Woodleaf. And it was exciting to be in charge of these girls. And I felt like I was finally feeling like I belonged to something. However, this is exactly when my whole life changed and was challenged by a younger junior counselor, no less. A teenager asked me a question, and I honestly cannot tell you what the question was, but I do remember my uneducated and naive answer to her was that God helps those who help themselves. And before we could move on, the junior counselor stopped the whole study in front of the girls, and she said, "That's not an actual scripture in the Bible, you know." Well, I was humiliated. I didn't know that. I had actually heard that saying on Bonanza or some TV show that always had some kind of a moral and values to it. I was petrified that someone would find out that I really didn't actually know who or what I was talking about. And I was counseling these kids. But as it happened, the next day we had a counselor's meeting where the camp manager was encouraging all of us to go out and take some time to recommit our lives to Christ, to ask Jesus to give us his heart and his eyes as we led our teen challenges to see him more clearly and to hear him more clearly. And hopefully encourage these guys, these young teenagers, to dedicate their lives to Christ. Well, needless to say, I didn't rededicate my life, but I gave my life fully to Jesus at that very moment. My dedication to Jesus prompted me to remember all the things that I had heard along the way. And I heard them over and over again, but I never processed them personally for my life. And that I was chosen to be in a relationship with Jesus Christ, the Son of God, and that he was my personal Savior. And since then, for about 40 years or so, I've dedicated all that I am and do in the name of Jesus. The scripture that's meant so much to me since then is Ephesians 1:3-7. Now, I first read it in the New Testament, paraphrased version. It was the J.B. Phillips version. Right here is my old one. It's used and abused and very well written in. And it was called The Cookbook because it was looked a lot like a cookbook. And that's what Young Life called it. And I found that these verses matter a great deal to me. They describe the blessings that I could have and I was given as a result of my salvation through Christ. And I loved knowing that God chose me and all of us to be adopted into his family. And that meant a lot to me. The Bible says that every time someone asks Jesus for a plan, he reminds them of their purpose. And my purpose has been to live a life in a relationship with Jesus and to share him with those that I come in contact with. And for most of my life, it was with teenagers. And for the last 15 years or so, it's been through congregational ministry and especially women's ministry. Every step of my life since that summer at Woodleaf has been a reminder of how I was chosen to be in the family of God. I was loved, I'm cherished, responsible to share my knowledge with all that I come in contact with. I hope you know Jesus. It's been a great life journey.
Come out of sadness from wherever you've been. Come brokenhearted, let rescue begin. Come find your mercy, you sinner, come here. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Earth has no sorrow that heaven can't heal. Lay down.
Yeah. There's a story in the Old Testament in the book of Genesis about two brothers. They were actually twin brothers. The younger one was named Jacob, and he was a bit of a con man. He figured out ways to swindle people and get things he wanted, and it usually didn't work out very well for him. In fact, one of the things he did was he ripped off his older brother, whose name was Esau. I'm not sure what he was thinking. I don't know if you have an older brother, but if he's that much bigger and that much meaner than you, you probably don't want to rip him off. But Jacob swindled him out of his inheritance as well as the family blessing. So, as a result, Jacob had to leave town. Well, Jacob and his family lived in what is now modern-day Israel. Let me just draw his little house there. There's the Dead Sea and the Sea of Galilee, and this is the Mediterranean Sea. And he had to run away to a town called Haran, which was about 600 miles north of him, about like running from St. Louis to Cleveland nowadays. So partway on his journey, Jacob stopped and camped for the night. He put a rock behind his head and promptly fell asleep. And while he was asleep, he had this strange dream of a ladder that reached from heaven to earth, and there were angels going up and down on the ladder. And at the very top of the ladder, God himself was standing, and God spoke to Jacob and gave him all kinds of promises about the land he was going to live in and the future that God had for him, and it was kind of a cool thing. So the next morning, Jacob woke up, and after thinking about that dream and his experience with God speaking to him and everything, he said one of my favorite things in the whole Old Testament. He said, "Wow, God is in this place, and I didn't even know it." And I love that. I think so many times in our lives, we're so busy, we're so active, we're so distracted, we kind of miss the fact that God is right here with us. Sometimes we don't even know it. But guess what? No matter what we're going through, God is right where you are too, and you might not know it. So hopefully this is a good encouragement for you, for all of us actually, that no matter where we live, what we're going through, or even if we're feeling kind of isolated and lonely right now, there's another great promise in the New Testament where Jesus says, "I am with you always." Maybe it's just a matter of just kind of asking him in faith, just kind of go, "I don't really know you're there, but I'm sure hoping you are, so would you just kind of show me what to do here?" And I think he'll do it.
In a time like this, it can feel like there's so much to pray for that we don't even know what to pray, or we wonder if our prayers even make a difference. But we know that God hears, and nevertheless, we pray. And this morning, I want to pray for the global pandemic, particularly as it starts affecting some more of the countries around the world, as more outbreaks start, and also in particular, the countries that are the most vulnerable and affected. And I also want to give thanks for the veterans who've lost their life as we remember Memorial Day. And after the prayer, we'll say the Apostles' Creed together, and the text will be on your screen. So would you pray with me, please? God, as the numbers keep growing, not only here but around the world, my heart, our hearts can't help but think of the many nations that are just running out of beds, and the outbreaks growing, and maybe they don't have enough testing. Places where people have a large family or multiple families living in a small home. Big cities that have very densely populated, and we think of cities in like India and Pakistan. We pray that you give people wisdom to make smart decisions, and we pray for the outbreak to not grow as much. We pray for the doctors and to know how to use the beds and what how to use resources best. And we pray for that people would be generous and give resources, especially from other developed countries that maybe are past their peak. We pray for people to come together and help, especially those places that are most vulnerable. We also think of Brazil and how poorly their leadership has been responding to the pandemic and how that will affect the millions of people there, especially, again, the people that are most at risk and poor and living in close quarters. And we pray that you would give wisdom to the leaders there to help respond better, God. And we're also thankful and we remember the veterans who've lost their lives. We're thankful for their service and sacrifice. And so this morning, if you have a loved one that you'd like to remember, let's take a moment of prayer silence to remember and pray for those who've given their lives. Amen. And so, like I said, we're going to do the Apostles' Creed. And the Apostles' Creed is an ancient creed saying. It's a way for us to affirm together, along with the generations who've gone before us and the generations who will come after us, the core and essential aspects of our faith. And one thing to remember that I think is helpful, especially if you're not as familiar with the Apostles' Creed, is that when we say Catholic with the lowercase c, it just means universal, meaning everyone. So lowercase c Catholic means everyone, universal. Let's say it together. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Hello, dear friends. As I sing this song, it's my prayer that you would receive a moment of peace, a moment of rest, as you reflect on the beauty of God. And if you don't find it at this moment, I do pray that for you at some point this week, that you would just have that moment of grace where God just slows you down for a minute and you're so aware of God's presence and you find rest there.
Thank you. Well, good morning, Cove. Big things going on this week, right? Important things, meaningful things. No, I'm not talking about the president's opinion on opening churches from his press conference Friday. I'll have something to say about that, actually, at the end of the service. No, I'm talking about Mimi, about Bev Nystrom getting to move into her house this week and being serenaded by honking cars and dozens of people wearing masks, being on TV, a big feature article. I hung it up here in the Press Democrat. Super exciting and fun to see at least a few of you who were able to pop in there. I also hung up on my bookshelf here this word trust that Anne made for our house. That was part of what she showed us from her studio on the midweek Wednesday video. We're hanging ours actually on the bathroom mirror, and I've actually loved these last days of getting up and immediately being reminded to ask, what can I trust God for today? And I keep being pulled back to those two things I gave you from a Henry Nouwen quote last Sunday, that we can trust God for two things. One, we can trust that God is with us. And two, we can trust that God will give us what we need the most. So it's been great to kind of wake up to that and have a visual reminder to think about that. Friends, before we get to the sermon text, I need to say a couple of things. Sometimes in the family of God, it is important to simply bring to awareness the brokenness and the happenings of our world and to name what's going on so that we can pray and act and change our world. And there's two things that are sort of heavy on my heart this morning. One is the story of Ahmaud Arbery, the young African-American man who was chased down, put on videotape, openly murdered by white citizens while jogging in Georgia at the end of February. And it was only after many weeks that there were any charges or arrests. And I am not here with you this morning to cover the details of that story. I don't really care about whether Arbery was on a construction site or not beforehand, or whether he had a criminal record or not. But the fact is that we want to think we live in a country where people hunting someone unarmed down and killing them in broad daylight should not happen. But it does. And over, it is African Americans being killed by white people. And the Church of Jesus needs to at least be willing to say, this is wrong. This is just so wrong. And to say it in public conversation and to say it in private conversation and to be involved in all sorts of other ways in trying to create an environment where it is universally seen as wrong and actually stops happening. I was encouraged this week. Someone sent me a full-page ad that ran in the Seattle Times newspaper. It had 150 names attached to it, all pastors and Christian leaders, many of whom I know actually from Seattle. And they signed a statement and put it in the paper, and it essentially said, this is wrong. In Jesus' name, it's wrong. And they said, as white evangelical Christian pastors and leaders, we stand beside African Americans to lament and to grieve and to call for justice. Now, there's so much other work to be done legally and politically and every other way, but sometimes as Christian people, we at least have to name things for what they are when they're wrong. In a similar way, if you follow the news, as I know most of you do, you are aware that since January and increasingly with continued toxic political rhetoric going on in our country, there have been dozens and dozens of incidents of harassment, threats, injury against Asian Americans and Pacific Islanders who have been blamed for bringing the coronavirus to the United States. All of those people have been presumed to be Chinese, though many were not, but they have been sworn at, they have been spit upon, they have been beat up, they have been physically assaulted on subways, in restaurants, on the streets. They've been screamed at, yelled, go back to China. Extremists have even accused them of concocting or spreading or even profiting from the virus. So the result is that we have Korean, Japanese, Samoan, Chinese Americans who are afraid to walk down the streets of their own neighborhoods. And this is so wrong. And as followers of Jesus, we need to know about that, speak about it, name it, intervene, support change in every way that we can. In a world that can be hostile, Jesus is our peace. Ephesians says he has destroyed the dividing walls of hostility between people. And we need to be ready and willing and working toward that day. And so I want to ask you to pray with me over these things before we look at our sermon text. Lord God, have mercy on us. Be with the families and people who have suffered loss and pain and injustice. In our day, the news is filled with people shouting and blaming and accusing and fabricating and acting violently toward other people. But we know that our world is also filled, Lord, with your Holy Spirit and with people who love peace and mercy and justice and who love you and who want to mend and heal in Jesus' name. And I would ask that you, Lord, help us to be those kind of people. In Jesus' name, amen. Okay, in the book of Exodus, the people of Israel are walking by faith, or trying to. They've been at it for a couple of months. We are walking by faith, or trying to. In 2020, we're a couple of months into this coronavirus journey. We've left behind a life that we knew and understood, even if it wasn't always good or easy. And we know we're en route to somewhere, and somewhere out ahead of us, there's a landing place, but the timeline is unknown, and what exactly that new land will look like for us is pretty hazy. Somewhere around 1400 BC, Israel has moved away from captivity as slaves in Egypt, and they're en route to the promised land. The only thing is, they don't know where that land is, and they don't know how long it's going to take to get there, and what exactly the new land will look like is pretty hazy to them. For us and for Israel, we are neither where we once were, nor are we near our destination. So we're in this messy middle, and we're unsure of our resources and even of our vision. And I would contend for both of us, for Israel and for us, that we might be in an ideal place to be trained up as God's people, walking by faith. If you're able this morning, wherever you are, I want to encourage you to stand for our reading of Scripture. I'm going to light the scripture candle just to mark our time in God's word together. This morning we're going to be reading from Exodus chapter 16, beginning with verse 19. Moses is speaking to the people about the manna that God has provided for them to eat. Then Moses said to them, "No one is to keep any of it until morning." However, some of them paid no attention to Moses. They kept part of it until morning, but it was full of maggots and began to smell. And so Moses was angry with them. Each morning, everyone gathered as much as they needed, and when the sun grew hot, it melted away. On the sixth day, they gathered twice as much, two omers for each person. And the leaders of the community came and reported this to Moses, and he said to them, "This is what the Lord commanded. Tomorrow is to be a day of Sabbath rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. So bake what you want to bake and boil what you want to boil. Save whatever's left and keep it until morning. And so they saved it until morning as Moses commanded, and it did not stink or get maggots in it. Eat it today, Moses said, because today is a Sabbath to the Lord. You will not find any of it on the ground today. 6 days you are to gather it, but on the seventh day, the Sabbath, there will not be any. Nevertheless, some of the people went out on the seventh day to gather it, but they found none. And then the Lord said to Moses, how long will you all, refuse to keep my commands and my instructions? Bear in mind that the Lord has given you the Sabbath. That is why on the sixth day he gives you bread for 2 days. Everyone is to stay where they are on the seventh day. No one is to go out. And so the people rested on the seventh day. Amen. And you may be seated. In the ritual celebration that begins the Jewish Sabbath, there's this beautiful prayer line that is reminds them of the danger of not keeping the Sabbath. So it's actually a confession. And it sounds like this. Days pass, years vanish, and we walk sightless among miracles. Days pass, years vanish, and we walk sightless among miracles. So God's people are walking. They're a couple months out of Egypt. They've received a number of miracles, which would seem to shout out at them, the Lord your God is with you. God has foiled the Egyptian army and destroyed them. He's parted the sea. He's rescued his people. He's given them water out of nowhere when they're thirsty, when they got hungry. He sends quail in the evening, manna in the morning. The people are walking among miracle after miracle, and yet already on the journey, this pattern is forming where they either don't see the miracles in front of them, or they forget them the second they have moved on and immediately start complaining. We walk sightless among miracles. Now, the last miracle that we read about last week was the sending of the manna, that wafery, thin substance that appeared on the ground the first thing in the morning and could be gathered and made into bread to eat. Moses passes on God's instructions that they're not to hoard it, just gather enough for one day, but there's some in every crowd, right? Some of them wouldn't do that. They saved some for the next morning, and sure enough, it was rotten, exactly as they'd been warned. And Moses kind of rolls his eyes, exasperated that they couldn't follow instructions, or maybe more exasperated that they couldn't recognize the miracle. So do we? Jesus is going to come along centuries later and reference this exact story. If we don't recognize the miracles of God in creation, in new life, in circumstances, in the people around us, in the presence of the Holy Spirit, if we don't recognize the miracles of God in all those ways, how will we recognize the far greater miracle of God himself coming to us in Christ and giving himself on the cross? Jesus said in John 6, I am the bread that came down from heaven. Your ancestors, he said, ate the manna in the wilderness, and yet they still died. But I am the living bread that came down from heaven, and whoever eats this bread will live forever. We walk sightless among miracles. So the Israelites keep walking. On the sixth day, it miraculously happens that they gather exactly twice as much as normal, and Moses carefully explains it to them. Tomorrow is a day of Sabbath rest, a holy Sabbath to the Lord. So do your baking or boiling, whatever you want to do, and then save your leftovers for tomorrow. Just on this one day, your leftovers will last. And it happens exactly this way. And the next morning, Moses reinforces what he had told them. Now's the time to pull out your leftovers and eat it. This is what God has provided. There's not going to be any on the ground this morning on the seventh day because it's a Sabbath day. Now, of course, some of the people, and there's some in every crowd, right? Ignored that utterly and went out in the morning to look and somehow seemed surprised that nothing was there. And this time it's the Lord who sort of rolls his eyes exasperated. Really? I gave you instructions. Which part of 6 days did you not understand? So God tries again. The Lord your God has given you the Sabbath. You get double manna on the sixth day so that you don't have to get up and gather it on the seventh. And finally, the people get it. And on the seventh day, they rest. Now the Hebrew word is Shabbat, that we hear as Sabbath. Do you know what Shabbat means? Well, the highly technical translation of Shabbat that I had to go to seminary for 3 years to learn is Shabbat means stop. That's all. Stop, cease, desist, Sabbath, rest. And very importantly, here in the middle of this journey, God gives Sabbath. It is a gift. Okay, so imagine with me two houses, next door neighbors, in an average neighborhood somewhere in the Bay Area. In the first house, every Friday morning, the energy level in the house ramps up. An extra trip to the store so that shopping doesn't have to happen the next day. An extra preparation in the kitchen so that cooking doesn't have to happen the next day. Extra checking to make sure that clothes are clean and the supply of candles and matches is adequate. And by the time Friday sundown arrives, all is ready. It's the Jewish Sabbath. And the flurry of activity slows and stops. And for the next 24 hours, life will be different. Guests are greeted. Candles are lit. Sabbath is personified and welcomed in song. The Sabbath liturgy and prayer begins, followed by the meal. The rest has started and extends into the next day. And depending on their exact practice, this Jewish family may only walk short distances, not drive their car, spend the day at the park or somewhere else enjoying each other's company. Now, next door to them on the same block, at 7 a.m., the front door swings open and mom sprints out of the house with her briefcase in hand, running for the bus and calling instructions over her shoulder. And a moment later, dad hurriedly shuttles the three kids out to the minivan, drops off one at the middle school, one at the elementary school, one at the daycare. And while driving to work, dad calls mom on the cell phone on the bus, making sure they have their assignments for the day. Okay. You pick up Jack at Freddie's house after school, grab him something to eat, and get him to youth group. I'll pick up Sonia from soccer practice and make sure she starts on her homework. And for heaven's sake, don't forget Eric at daycare again. What about dinner? Pick something up. What time will you be home? Can we switch cars at 6 so I can fit more soccer players in? Which of us is going to stop by the open house at school? Oh, and the board meeting is tonight. Dang, I'll have to skip that. And don't forget, I'm leaving tomorrow for LA. I'll pack tonight. At 10:30 p.m., the kids are barely in bed. Field trip permission slips have been totally forgotten. Mom is on Facebook while she watches a repeat of The Office, and dad has fallen asleep in the chair with earphones on. And the next morning at 7 a.m., the front door swings open and mom sprints for the bus. If this family had time to pray, it might sound very similar to the Sabbath confession. Lord, we were in such a rush. Life was so busy that we missed you. Days pass, years vanish, and we walk sightless among miracles. Friends, Sabbath is a gift from God. We're invited to receive it. Sabbath is not earned. It's not hoarded. Sabbath is not a list of things that we cannot do. Sabbath is much more than something we have to do. It's something that we get to do. Sabbath is a gift. And when God set up the Sabbath, a time of rest as part of the very order of creation, He declared its important by its importance by actually practicing it himself. In Genesis, of course, God works 6 days and rests on the seventh day, and thereby proclaims just how good creation is, that God would rest and take pleasure in what he had made. Sabbath is to be enjoyed, a day set apart, different from all the other days. And I don't think I have to tell you actually how countercultural this actually is. One day of rest, one day of getting off the gerbil wheel, one day for what Eugene Peterson describes as simply praying and playing, praying and playing. Eugene actually said once that most of our world practices half Sabbaths. You play, you pray, but you don't play. You pray, but you don't play. That's a half Sabbath, and that's kind of the puritanical, legalistic Sabbath. Or, on the other hand, you play, but you don't pray, which is what the vast majority of our culture does with Sundays. But what if you had one day where everything that you did had to fit under one of those two categories? Praying, so worship, prayer, quiet, music, reading. Praying, or playing, taking walks, going to the beach, taking a bike ride, time with friends and family. What if you had one day like that where you simply were able to reflect on where life had come or where it was going, one day to enjoy God's good creation, listen to good music, read poetry, go to a museum? If you did that for one day, you would feel better. I guarantee. Your mind would be clearer. Your vocational work in the days following would be better. Study after study has proven that to be true. And it's not rocket science. Farmers have always known that they need to periodically let their crops, their land, lie fallow to recuperate. Athletes know that periodically they have to take a day off and rest. Your faith needs a day to play and pray, and it will be stronger. As difficult as this pandemic time is, as much pain and loss as there is right now, I was wondering this week if this quarantine time might be used to set a different pattern in our life. Some of us, at least, not everyone, but some of us are being handed more time right now than we ever dreamed of. In some ways, we have no choice but to practice some Sabbath. What will we walk away with at the end of this time that maybe changes the way that we live for the better? But we might say with the Israelites, it is hard to receive this gift. And it absolutely is. You know why? Because Sabbath is the antithesis of productivity. And our world that we live in, that we, for most of us, buy into most of the time, is all about productivity. You are what you produce. It is your work that defines you. It is your activities that define you. We are what we do. But what if that's not true? What if in the graciousness of God, we are love beyond measure, period? What if we had a day where we couldn't produce, we couldn't accomplish something? Well, I'll tell you what would happen. At first, we would be driven crazy. But maybe over time, maybe not producing one day would help us remember who we are. Israel wasn't chosen by God because of something it had accomplished. God did not invite us to be part of his family because of what we've achieved. God chose out of grace, and we are dependent, utterly dependent on him. And Sabbath practice can help us reclaim that knowledge and that identity. It's humbling, and we need it. The writer Tilden Edwards once said, "Stopping work tests our trust." Will the world and I fall apart if I stop making things happen for a while? I think maybe the single most radical way we could live out our life in Jesus in this culture might actually be to practice Sabbath. Because we live in a 24/7 world that resists taking space, having silence, listening, and leisure. And Sabbath, again, is not just legalistic obedience. It is a gift given to us. It is a way to live. And let's not forget that in our story, we haven't even made it to the Ten Commandments yet. That doesn't happen until Exodus chapter 20. So before Sabbath was included as law or commandment or instruction, Sabbath was given as grace, as a gift that would bless and flourish life in the community of God's people. I want to close this morning by reading once more the line of confession from the Jewish prayer book, but then also the rest of the prayer. Days pass and years vanish, and we walk sightless among miracles. Lord, fill our eyes with seeing and our minds with knowing. Let there be moments when your presence, like lightning, illumines the darkness in which we walk. Help us to see, wherever we gaze, that the bush burns unconsumed, and we, clay touched by God, will reach out for holiness and exclaim in wonder, how filled with awe is this place, and we did not know it. Blessed is the Eternal One, the Holy God. Amen. So friends, it's been good to be in worship together. One more quick thing as we conclude our worship. As I mentioned, President Trump made a rather large and brief statement on Friday about ordering houses of worship to be able to open. I don't know all that was trying to do. What I do know is that I'm thankful that closed church building doors have not kept us from worshiping or connecting as God's people, and this has been a great blessing during this time. And what we do know is that the state of the pandemic is the same today that it was on Friday, that 100,000 people have died and 1.6 million people have been sick in the United States, five times higher than other countries. We know that it is prolonged large group gatherings that are the most dangerous. The medical guidelines for our state, our county, are the same as they were before that 2-minute press conference. So this does not mean there is some magical new information or that we can safely gather together. So just to be clear, we're not going to be jumping into gathering back together. Now, you know, I'm sure, but our session, our leaders at the Cove, myself, we are as eager to be back together as you are. But we care about the safety of the people of the Cove and all of the community around us. And so we'll continue to monitor, to listen for the guidelines that will slowly let us edge back towards meeting together. That's going to take time. It will undoubtedly be small groups first, masks, hand cleaner, social distancing, no singing, other things to progress safely. Because what we don't want to do is rush, as some churches are doing, and regret it later. Two churches in Northern California, others in Texas and Georgia, aggressively pushed to meet and ended up almost immediately with hundreds of people exposed, dozens of people sick, and several people actually dying. So we are going to keep being patient, and I'm asking you to trust that we are planning, paying attention, praying, and proceeding carefully. We are on a slow walk, but we're doing it together. As we conclude, remember there's a Zoom virtual coffee hour that you can plug into. The link is on the same email that you received the link for the service. We've had a good time of getting to actually talk and listen and ask questions and laugh together over Zoom. So I invite you to that. Now receive the benediction from Micah chapter 6. God has shown you what is good and what the Lord requires of you: to act justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. May it be so this day in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. And all God's people enthusiastically said, Amen.